Firdaus for your actually so many adjectives you have used for me. I am really overwhelmed, and I think it's too much from your side. Whenever you talk about me, you talk too much, and I was actually worried about you, that what you are going to say now. So now we are going to start our lecture in the month of independence. As Firdaus has already mentioned, that we are celebrating the golden jubilee of our Independence Day this year. And in this occasion, this is our gift actually, or this is from our side a small attempt to do something for our students who are now in some or other courses of pediatric cardiology, and also for our junior pediatric cardiologists. So today's subject is a little bit difficult, and I will try to tell you in an easy way so that you will be able to learn at the end. And I will present the whole papers in a pictorial form so that you will be able to understand what actually it is. So first we'll start with the history of pediatric cardiology. Modern pediatric cardiology deals with the heart of a child, which starts from the conception period, and then it travels through the fetus, then newborn, then infancy period, teenagers, childhood, and then up to the maturity, and then even up to the adult age. And the pediatric cardiology as a discipline, it arose from early descriptive studies of the congenital heart defects mainly. So acquired heart diseases were not that much in the concern. When congenital heart disease came into scenario, then the subject pediatric cardiology was born. Now, who are the member of the team of the pediatric cardiology? All of you know that morphologists or anatomists, they are the main member who has described various chambers of the heart from very ancient time. And then the pathologist, physiologist, cardiologist, cardiac surgeons, interventionist, everybody has role, including the molecular biologist and geneticist. So if we see the history, there is a plenty of human follies. That means it was a kind of foolishness. By doing some foolishness, something were innovated. Serendipity, that means a by chance innovation, or a great result from unintentional effort. So initial innovations were like this. It was out of like foolishness or unintentional achievement of something very novel or very good. And a grand play of the chance, in course, brilliant human endeavor was added with that. And that land into the subject of the difficult most subspecialty, the pediatric cardiology. There are several Renaissance men. And we heard in last century about Nada, then about Van Praagh, then about the Anderson, but they are the youngest of the older people. There are many other older people who worked on it long, long ago. And you will see some of the example from this presentation. About the modern pediatric cardiology, it was only in 1938 when Robert Gross ligated a patent ductus arteriosus, then the discipline of the pediatric cardiology, the modern pediatric cardiology, was born. And if we think about the time before the birth of Christ, Galen, a Greek physician, he gave a clear description for the first time of the patent foramen ovale and the arterial duct and their normal closure after birth. So he was the brilliant one who identified these two holes, along with the history that these two holes spontaneously closed after birth. And then came the great artist Leonardo da Vinci in 15th century. He first drew the picture of the atrial septal defect. And this is his drawing. You are seeing here that he has drawn the heart and blood vessel in 15th century. So he is the greatest artist. And there was a lot of science behind his art. So he has blended the science and art together in that ancient time. there are different eras in the development of the pediatric cardiology. Even if we take 500 years together, so by 2020, we passed through 400-500 years. And in every 500 years, there were some innovation, there were some or other innovation, and clinical acumen, understanding of the physiology, anatomy, angiography, and most importantly, development of the extracorporeal membrane circulation. This allowed the caring of the children, especially after the congenital heart surgery, in a place where we are seeing that almost 99.9% patients are now surviving. So if we share about some of the milestones, you will see that first one in 1628 was the innovation of the two circulations, which was very important innovation, pulmonary circulation and systemic circulation. This was an innovation of the William Harvey. And then Lennox, he innovated the stethoscope in 1819, which made the diagnosis of the heart sound murmur easier later on. And then basically he recorded the human blood pressure first time, but before that blood pressure was recorded in the horse. And then Peacock, he localized the murmur in 1858. Fick innovated the Fick principle. You know, we use the Fick principle in the cath lab for oxygen consumption, for calculation of the cardiac output and others. And it was innovated in 1870, long, long ago. And then Roger, he specified the murmur or noise over the heart in 1879. Then the physiology of the murmur, like why these murmurs were created, these were innovated by Gibson in 1911. And Abbott is the first person in 1936. He has compiled all the clinical findings and then he prepared the diagrams. He correlated all those findings with the X-ray and the ECG, and he prepared a beautiful atlas. And this was in 1936. And I have mentioned already that Robert Gross, he was the one who ligated the ductus arteriosus for the first time in a 7-year-old girl in 1938. And then Fallot, you all know about the Fallot, who has innovated the tetralogy in 1888. Then Frank Starling's law, you know, the stretching of the cardiac muscle fiber or the muscle cell of the heart, it actually determines the force of contraction, and it was innovated in 1914. And then Helen Tosic, she correlated the pathology. She has identified in the autopsy, she correlated those with the ECG and the fluoroscopy findings. So Helen Tosic, she was a great cardiologist of her time. And then in 1974, Walt Lehely and associates, they innovated the diseases and their clinical features and everything in BSD, tetralogy of Fallot, atrioventricular septal defect, and their circulations. And what she did that, what they did, they did the surgery by using a human being as the pump. Nowadays, we use cardiopulmonary bypass. And from that, we enter oxygenated blood into the body and we take away the deoxygenated blood from the body. But in that time, human body was used. Arterial blood was pushed into the patient's body and venous blood was taken into the patient's body. So a human being was used as a pump, because definitely that patient was a big one, that person that who was the donor was the big one, and his blood pressure and everything was more than that of the tiny babies. So he himself worked as a pump. Considering the architect of extracorporeal circulatory support, it was John Gibson in 1953, he innovated the extracorporeal circulation system. And then Ruskin, he innovated the first life-saving intervention, who has saved the life of hundreds and thousands of children, hundreds and thousands of newborn babies, is the Ruskin, the balloon atrial septostomy in 1966. Blalock Tosic Shunt, same way like that of the Ruskin. In 1944, he innovated that cyanosis of the patient can be reduced by doing an anastomosis between a systemic artery and the pulmonary artery, and that was the innovation of the BT shunt. and then Forsman in 1928. He was a surgical resident. He himself passed a catheter through his hand, and in there too a cardiac catheterization was started for the first time in 1929. And then Nadas, he is a renowned cardiologist. In 1960, he studied on the natural history of the congenital heart disease, and he found that which disease a patient, how long he will survive if no correction is done, and if any correction is done, how long he will survive. So that was the natural history. He innovated all those. And then the palliative procedure of Norwood operation on hypoplastic left heart syndrome, it was by the Norwood in 1981. And Jetten, we know that arterial switch operation, before it was called Jetten operation. So Jetten operation, it was first successfully done by Jetten in 1976. Then Jean Kahn in 1981, he was the one who did first balloon valvoplasty on pulmonary valve. And Fontan is the one in 1971, he innovated that how pulmonary circulation or the deoxygenated blood in single ventricle situation can be separated from the oxygenated blood by directly bypassing those blood into the lungs. So that was a great innovation by the Fontan in 1971. And then in 1990s, there were a lot of latest innovations, and now the long-term survival of the surgery and the intervention, these are very good, not only because of the development of the skill among the specialists, but also for the innovation of the nitric oxide, ECMO, and many other kind of ventilatory supports, then high flow oxygen, then many other things. And development of the pediatric electrophysiology as well, and specialized care for the adult congenital heart disease, because many of the adults, they are also suffering with the, they are the survivor of the minor or less critical form of congenital heart disease, and they also need care. So ACHD is another important subject now. And understanding the genetic mutation of the congenital heart disease is very important. And now we are getting that genes are related even with the tetralogy of fellow, even with pulmonary atresia, even with many kind of congenital heart diseases. So these are all about the important landmark in the history of pediatric cardiology. And I think all the students in the pediatric cardiology, they should know about our past, and they should know the history. So segmental analysis and terminology is our next segment. And we know that nomenclature and terminology, these are very, very important for the complex congenital heart disease. In simple heart disease like ASD, VSD, PDA, you don't need to bother on those things. But if it is a complex, you need to know how to identify each and every structure of the heart and how to know the position and their topology. So now we'll discuss on this very important chapter. One of the fascinations of pediatric cardiology is its complexity. However, this complexity and the various terminologies that strive to express it often baffle interested outsiders, adult cardiologists, pediatricians, internists, radiologists, because they don't understand these things. So you are the one who has to explain them the complexity. So to make the complex thing a simple one, you have to find a way by which you can simplify the things. So analysis of the heart in terms of its major developmental units are, or in terms of segments and in terms of step-by-step analysis is the very important one. So in this part, we can divide the heart into three segments, which is visceral atrial situs, ventricular loop, and conotruncus segment. So visceral atrial situs, another name is the atrial situs, ventricular loop is the ventricular loop, and conotruncus is the great artery relationship. So in a systematic manner, we can see which structures at the right-sided structure, which structures at the right, left-sided structure, because in each three of the segment, there are double-double structure. Some of the structure we know are right-sided, but we know these are right-sided, but this may appear on the left side of the heart. We know these are left-sided, but they may appear on the right side of the heart. So what is important is you have to know the morphology And then along with the morphology of each and every segment, you have to know the relative position of those segments. Because in complex congenital heart disease, right side will go to where you don't know where the right side will stay and what will be the topological relation or spatial relation of the structure with each other. So here is the atria. You are seeing that this first segment is the atrial segment. This is the right atrium. You can identify from your vena cava connection and also from the coronary sinus. And these are four pulmonary veins. And these are the pulmonary veins. So this is the atrial situs solitus situation. And then the ventricles you are seeing here, the D-loop ventricle, where the right ventricle is on the right side of the left ventricle, and L-loop ventricle, the left ventricle is on the left side. And here is the great arteries you are seeing. So I will repeat this after every few slides so that you will memorize this from here today, those who are the students. So here you are seeing that atria, here it is posterior and to the right side. So great artery relation, aorta is posterior and to the right, and pulmonary artery, it is anterior and to the left. So anterior and left is the pulmonary artery, and posterior and right is the aorta. So from here, we have seen three segments, but there are also three connections. What are these? These are atrioventricular connection. So the top one is the atrioventricular connection. This one is a aorta ashana aorta. This one, the upper AV canal is the atrioventricular connection, and the lower conus is the ventriculo-arterial connection. And we can describe the three segments as house also. So in the first tier of the house, we are seeing the first segment, the atrium. Second segment, the second tier is the ventricle, and third is the great arteries, and they are connected with the stair, which is atrioventricular connection and ventriculo-arterial connection. So in this house, there are two sides, right and left. Right atrium, left atrium, right ventricle, left ventricle, and this is the pulmonary artery and the aorta. Now we will enter into other parts. So as usual, these are the three parts again. So I said I'll show you again and again so that you will be able to remember this, all this at the end of this lecture. So here again, you are seeing the three segments of the heart, atrial segment, ventricular segment, and the atrial segment, and heart at the basal level, the cut section of the heart at the basal level, you are seeing all the four valves. So this is a tri-leaflet valve, this is a bileaflet mitral valve, and this is the aortic valve, which is posterior, and the pulmonary valve, which is anterior. So there are some universal points. Before going to the morphology and study of the individual part, we should know some of the universal points in relation to the terminology and nomenclature. What is that? The first one is the situs. Situs, what is situs? Situs is the topology or the spatial relation or their condition or their situation inside the thoracic cavity. So situs refers to the topology or the position of the heart and its components, like three segments, inside the thoracic cavity, and it describes the position of the cardiac atrium and viscera in the system. So one thing you remember from today, that among the cardiac structure, atrial situs always correlates with the visceral situs. So if atrium is situs solitus, then all the viscera will be situs solitus. And we will learn all this thing gradually. So there are three organs, like cardiovascular system, respiratory system, and the digestive system, that determines the sidedness. Because these structures, other than the respiratory structures, are actually single-sided. Heart is a single-sided, liver is a single-sided, then stomach is a single-sided. So other than respiratory, all the structures are single-sided structure, which usually stay in one side of the vertebral column. So we have to determine which side is normal for whom. So sidedness, maybe normal one, maybe mirror image one, maybe or or the inversus one, isomeric one. Isomeric means duplication, or indeterminate, where we cannot determine whether it is a right-sided structure or a left-sided structure. We cannot come to any conclusion. Now, right isomerism indicates the bilateral right-sidedness. So liver, right lobe of the liver will be on both sides. Right bronchus will be on both sides. And where in left isomerism, left side is structured like spleen, there will be multiple spleen, and then there might be two stomach, and their liver will not be like the big one, the big right lobe. So right isomerism or right duplication, where the spleen is usually absent because spleen is not a right-sided structure. So when right will duplicate on the left side, there will be no spleen. And in left isomerism, if left side is duplicated on the right side, then you will get many spleen. So for simplification, when right will multiply, there will be no spleen. When left will multiply, there will be many spleen. And occasionally, a splenia or polysplenia may have normal heart. In some normal situation, without any isomerism, there may be a splenia or polysplenia. And rarely, those with atrial isomerism may have normal spleen. So this is vice versa. Asplenia and polysplenia are not the sole property of the isomerism. They may be present without any isomerism, and there may be polysplenia or asplenia with normal heart even. So this is the CT scan. You are seeing a CT scan here, coronal image, and this is a two-year-old girl. And you are seeing here that this is the principal bronchus. This is also a principal bronchus. But both are same. There is no right principal bronchus here. These are long left principal bronchus. So this is the left isomerism in the bronchus. And you are seeing here that there are so many spleen, 3-4 spleen here. So this is a case of left isomerism. And then that is about the viscera. Now, if we come to the cardiac sidedness, which is determined by the position of the morphological right atrium. So I have mentioned you earlier that right atrium is the main target point for deciding the cardiac sidedness or also for deciding the cardiac situs. So you have to identify right atrium, which is very important. So cardiac sidedness or the cardiac situs is not determined by the position of the cardiac apex or the base to apex axis of the heart. So the morphological right atrium, it must be in the right side of the heart. And normally it is right sided, but it might be in the left side of the heart in case of situs inversus, which is the mirror image sidedness. So another name of the situs inversus is the mirror image sidedness. And sometime you will get right atrium in the left side in situs inversus, and sometime you will get right atrium in both sides of the heart. What is that? This is the right isomerism. You will get two right atrium, and you will not get any of the left atrium. In bilateral left atrium or left isomerism, you will not get any of the right atrium. So there will be two left atrium on two sides of the heart. So here is the summary. You are seeing that in the photo, you see that this is the right atrium. Why it is right atrium? Because this is the right atrial appendage, which is broad, triangular, and this is the left atrium, which is finger-like appendage. So left atrium, in right side and left side as usual, which is very normal. And in this picture, you are seeing that just the inversus position of the same thing, which is like this is situs inversus. Now here you are seeing that right isomerism. You see the two appendages here are the same right atrial appendages. And here two appendages are left atrial appendages. So this is the left isomerism. And first one, picture C, is the right isomerism. Now we can go to the pulmonary sidedness. Pulmonary sidedness is decided by the position of the, as I have mentioned already, is the principal bronchus, and also the position of the first lower bronchus in relation to its pulmonary artery. So if right, usually we see that right pulmonary artery remain in front of the first lower bronchus and left pulmonary artery remain at the back side of the first lower bronchus. So these are the identification point for identifying the isomerism in the lungs. So if there is isomerism, there will be two right lobe or two left lobe, according to the type of isomerism. So here you are seeing that in normal lung, you are seeing the first photo. The first one here, you see that right pulmonary artery is in front of the first upper lobe bronchus. And here the left pulmonary artery is behind the first upper lobe And if you see the principal bronchus, you will see that the left principal bronchus from the carina to the first point of branch is 1.5 to 2.5 times longer than that of the right principal bronchus. So this is a way to identify. In first picture, you are seeing the normal distribution, and here is the mirror image in situs inversus situation. But here you are seeing the right isomerism, where right bronchus, right principal bronchus is 2, and right pulmonary artery is 2, which is crossing in front of the first lobe, first lobar bronchus. And here both are crossing behind the first lobar bronchus. So these are the very, very important identification mark for identifying isomerism. And in the cath lab, we usually see this in the fluoroscopy, and we can identify in the cath lab also. So these are some important common points. Now we'll come to the sequential assessment. First of all, we'll see the thoracoabdominal situs, which is very important for echocardiographic assessment. And then we'll do the cardiac positioning, whether it is left, right, or middle. And then atrial situs, as I have mentioned, then atrioventricular connection, then ventricle, then corners, then ventricular arterial, then great vessel and its relationship. So all these steps we have to follow to diagnose a complex congenital heart disease. These are not required in simple diseases, but for the complex disease, you must know these things. So first of all, we can see what is abdominal situs. Abdominal situsness is usually determined by the location of the liver and stomach. We know that liver is the signatory of the right side and stomach is the signatory of the left side. So if we see these are okay, so we can say that this is a normal situs. And with the spleen and pancreas, it's usually on the same side of the vertebral column as that of the stomach. So stomach, spleen, and pancreas, they are in the same side and liver is on the other side. And there are three different types of possibilities in the visceral abdominal situs solitus. What are these? These are situs solitus, which is the normal, as I have mentioned. And then situs inversus, which is just like the mirror image of the normal one. And ambiguous, where you will not be able to say anything, whether it is a situs solitus or it is a situs inversus. So these are not that much easy to describe. So in this picture, again, you just recapitulate the previous pictures. And now you see that in first picture, you are seeing the three lobe and three principal bronchus here, three lower bronchus here, two here. Here again, two here and three here. So this is what? This is the inversus. And again, see here, three, what is it? So three is the right-sided lungs. So it is a right isomerism. Two, here, what is it? So this is a left-sided structure. So this is left isomerism. And you can correlate with the lungs here also. And here you can see that this is the right-sided liver, this is the left-sided stomach, spleen, and pancreas, if it is here. And then this is just the mirror image of the first picture, and this is an ambiguous. You cannot say anything on this. So this is an ambiguous. So ambiguous is something where you cannot identify, but ambiguous is usually associated with the right isomerism or with the left isomerism. So again, to keep this picture in your mind, I am using this photography again and again. So you can see that this is the normal, three lobes on the right, two lobe on the left, right atrial appendage on the right, left atrial appendage on the left, liver on the right, and stomach on the left. So this is all about the visceral situs solitus. This is the visceral situs inversus. Everything is just reverse of the first one. And then again, if we see the lungs, as lungs is a bilateral structure, we don't see ambiguity that much in the lungs. Lungs you will be able to identify. Otherwise, the patient will not survive because it is the place for ventilation permission, and a notorious kind of thing should not be there. Otherwise, the patient will die immediately after birth. So you are seeing here that what is here in the first picture is a normal one with the three lobes here, two lobes here, two lobes here, three lobes here. And so this is one with the right isomerism, this is. So I think by this, by now, all the students, you have understood that what is right isomerism, what is left isomerism. So this one, asplenia, is the right isomerism. Here, liver is duplicated. This is right isomerism. And here, there is no spleen, and there are two stomach-like structures. And This is left isomerism. So ambiguity goes with right or left isomerism. And asplenia syndrome goes with the right isomerism. Polysplenia syndrome goes with the left isomerism. And one thing to mention here that if you see that there is asplenia in some of the patients, after getting isomerism, you have to do the ultrasonography of the abdomen to check the spleen. If you see that spleen is absent, you have to add an antibiotic penicillin for the patient for protection against the capsulated organism. So this is one of the picture. Again, we are repeating. And in the first one, you are seeing that cecum is also a part of the, part of this isomerism or the situs. Cecum is usually in the right side. Here you are seeing in the left side. And here you are seeing there is a male rotation because of the right isomerism. Because cecum is a right-sided structure and it has duplicated, so it has rotated. And here is the left isomerism, and this structure has become a little bit bigger than that of the normal because it is a left-sided structure. So he has the right to stay here with more force. So this is the visceral structure inside the abdomen and inside the thorax. You can again recapitulate that what is it? There are livers. And what is here? This is the male rotation of the bowel here. Here is also male rotation of the bowel. And both the patient are with the asplenia. Both of them, there is no spleen. So if there is no spleen, what is it? I think you will be able to answer now that this is a asplenia syndrome, which goes with the right isomerism. Again, we are going to the bronchus. You see now this one is 2.5 times. Times more than that of this one. So what is it? This is the left bronchus, but it is on the right side. So this is the mirror image of this one. And again, you are seeing here that this photograph is very important. I will request you to remember this photograph. This is the vertebral column. And when we start our echocardiography, we first take this cut over the abdomen just to tell about the situs. So what this picture is indicating. This is the inferior vena cava and this is the aorta. In normal situation, inferior vena cava is on the right side of the spine and aorta is on the left side. But what happened if there is isomerism? And in mirror image, you will say you will find exactly the mirror image picture. But here, in the right isomerism and left isomerism, you will be able to diagnose from the very first moment of the echocardiography by seeing the aorta and the inferior vena cava. So what will happen in the right isomerism as right-sided structure is duplicated. So inferior vena cava is dominating here. So he will come to the left side and he will dominate over the aorta and he will be on the top position. So just memorize, as in right isomerism, inferior vena cava is dominating, he will come to the, he will change his side. He will come to the left side and take the dominant position over the aorta here. Here again is the left isomerism. Here again, vena cava will change its position. It will be on the left side, but now it is not dominant. It is submissive. So it will be small one. It will be in the lower level of the aorta. So aorta is powerful now because it is left isomerism. So just remember, every time both the structure in both isomerism will be on the same side, but in right isomerism, inferior vena cava will be the dominating structure, will be in the top of the field, and in the left isomerism, aorta will be in the top of the field. So in this way, you'll be able to identify isomerism from the very first cut of your echocardiography study. Now we come to the cardiac. We have to mention whether the heart is in the left side or in the right side or in the middle, which is levocardia, dextrocardia, mesocardia, and even sometime heart is out of the thoracic cavity, which is ectopia cordis. So in this picture, you are seeing the leftward apex, then rightward apex and the midline. And in the lower picture, you are seeing inside the thoracic case, levocardia, dextrocardia, and mesocardia. But these are very, very complex, not so easy. So let us go to the complexity slowly. So just for the time being, remember that this is levocardia, dextrocardia, and mesocardia. Now the base and apex axis is independent of the cardiac sidedness. As I have mentioned earlier, base apex axis or the position of the apex inside the thoracic cavity has nothing to do with the cardiac sidedness. With situs inversus, cardiac apex may be on the left side sometime. Thus, the presence of a leftward apex does not necessarily imply the normal sidedness or situs solitus. So just remember this, that apical position is a separate entity, and it usually do not correlate with the situs. And right-sided apex does not correlate with the dextrocardia or situs inversus. And a midline apex, on the other hand, is usually associated with cardiac isomerism. So midline apex or mesocardia is most of the time a part of the complexity. So just remember, midline apex is a component of the complexity. So here is the cardiac base apex, and then again, I have mentioned, this is the axis. So you are seeing that this arrow is indicating the axis, and this axis has nothing to do with the position of the apex. Apex, even in this kind of axis, apex may be in the middle, maybe in the right side. And then another term is dextroposition. In dextroposition, heart has nothing to do. Heart is perfect. Heart is completely all right. But heart is pushed or pulled by the pneumothorax, by the emphysema, diaphragmatic hernia, or by the hypoplastic or agenesis of the heart. Now we are coming to an important point, is the apical rotation. I have mentioned to you that apical rotation has very important role in determining many, many complex heart diseases. So the final spatial position of the heart is determined by the apical rotation. And cardiac apex, it pivots to the hemithorax opposite to the bulboventricular. So this is a very, very important formula. You have to remember, it is like some of the formula we learned in our algebra in our school life, a plus b whole square equal to a square plus 2abc plus b square, like this. So this cardiac apex, the direction of the cardiac apex is always opposite to that of the bulboventricular loop. So if it is a D loop ventricle, apex will be on the right side, left side. And if it is an L loop ventricle, apex will be on the left side, on the right side. So in a normal D loop, the apex pivots to the left, and normal L loop, it will pivot to the right. And failure of the complete apical pivoting is commonly associated with the discordant connection and complexity. So you can see here that the pictures, you just see the pictures. These are very important pictures. First one is normal one. Second one is the, you are seeing that right atrium is connected to the left ventricle in the B picture, which means that there is atrioventricular discordant connection in this situation. And in L loop ventricle, you are seeing that apex is on the right side of the heart. And then superior, this apical rotation, another contribution of the apical rotation defect is the superior inferior ventricle, which is the abnormal tilting of the apex. And then crisscross ventricle, which is also the abnormal rotation in the longitudinal axis. So first one is the frontal axis will give rise to superior inferior, and longitudinal will give rise to crisscross. And then is the dextroversion, lack of apical pivoting in situs solitus. So dextroversion is a condition. This is another thing to discuss, that in even in the situs solitus situation, apex may rotate into the right side. And even in the D loop result in this side of the apex. In the first picture, you are seeing that this is a normal heart with the right atrium, left atrium, and everything is normal. And second one is the mirror image. But in the third picture, you are seeing that there is dextroversion in spite of the atrial situs solitus and D-loop ventricle, there is dextroversion. So dextroversion is not always associated with the situs inversus or with the L-loop ventricle. So morphology now, of the this is very important, and I will go quickly now. This is the right atrial thing. So you're seeing inside, you know all that, how to identify right atrium, fossa ovales and other things. So, and this is the identification inside of the right atrium. You are seeing pectinate muscle and the crista terminalis, and also the fossa ovales, tricuspid valve. These are the identification points, Eustachian valve. And this is the appendage, which is the broad-based triangular one. And this is the left atrium you're seeing, which is with the finger-like appendage and with the septum primum and septum secondum are the part inside the left side, left aspect of the atrium. So here you are seeing that septum primum and septum secundum. You can identify the left atrium by seeing these things. So in summary, right atrium, you can identify by seeing inferior vena cava, superior vena cava, left by pulmonary veins. And there are this is triangular broad base appendage, narrow finger-like appendix. So I think these things you have to memorize. And this is a simplification of the picture for you to keep in your mind. Last one is the situs ambiguus. And here you are seeing first one is the normal one with normal appendage, second one is the mirror image, and then in the left isomerism, you are seeing left atrial appendage 2 and right atrial appendage 2. And then common atrium, if there is no atrial septum in between, but there are normal right and left atrium, only absence of the septum. But same time, you will see the common atrium where you will not be able to identify which one is right atrium, which one is left atrium. In that case, there will be some problem, and that is the indeterminate type of atrium, and that is situs ambiguus. So indeterminate atrial morphology may happen. And then after the atrium, we'll come to the atrioventricular valves. These valves travel with their respective ventricles. So always remember, this is also a formula. The valves always travel with the ventricle. Tricuspid valve will always travel with the right ventricle, and mitral valve will always travel with the left ventricle. And you will never find any exception of this principle. So here we are seeing some of the part of the right ventricle, which I will show you in this picture. The atrioventricular septum you are seeing here, that this is that the first one, this is the tricuspid valve. You are seeing this attachment point is towards the apex, and here it is towards the atrium. So this is one of the very important identification point. Another one is it is septophilic. It remain attached with the septum, but it is septophobic. There is space between the septum and this one. So these two are the very important point, but there are many, many other points also. In one day, you cannot memorize everything, but these two you should not forget. So mitral valve, as I have mentioned, high septal annular attachment and elliptical orifice, whereas the tricuspid valve has triangular orifice, and there are two papillary large muscles inside the left ventricle, whereas there are so many papillary muscles inside the right ventricle. So normal ventricles are characterized by how many parts? There are three parts in each ventricle, inlet part, trabecular part, and outlet part. So you should call a structure a ventricle when he has inlet part, trabecular part, and the outlet part. They are not defined by the presence of all three or by the presence of any one in particular. With only rare exception, virtually all human heart contain two ventricular chambers. So all the human being, normal human being, they have two chambers. So this is Van Praagh, and I had the opportunity to meet him once in UK, USA. And he is such a learned person. We actually have not seen a kind of morphologist or anatomist like him in this current era. So he is the one who innovated the chirality or handedness theory in 1980 to identify right ventricle in situs solitus and situs inversus condition. So this is the chirality. You are seeing that we can consider our right hand, and we can put our right hand over the ventricular septal aspect of the right ventricle, and keep your thumb in the inlet, keep your index finger or all four fingers in the outlet, and keep your palm over the septum and free wall over the free wall of the right ventricle. This is the normal D loop ventricle. So just remember it. This is the normal D loop. And here is the normal L loop. If you keep your left hand, thumb will be in the inlet, index or other fingers will be in the outlet, and palm in the septum and free surface of the dorsum of the hand is on the free wall. So this is in the L loop. You can see from here again, to keep it in your memory, that how to keep your right hand to describe D loop right ventricle and left hand to describe L loop left ventricle. And just remember one, the tricuspid and pulmonary valve, there is no continuity between that. There is a big gap. In this picture, you are seeing this is the tricuspid valve endpoint, and this one is the pulmonary valve. This is the pulmonary valve. So there is a big gap in this part. So there is no tricuspid pulmonary continuity, whereas there is mitral aortic continuity. So you will be able to identify the ventricle by that also. So this is the moderator band inside the moderator band, and lot of papillary muscle you are seeing inside. So there are, these are small, but in the left ventricle, there are two big papillary muscle. There are multiple small papillary muscle here, and here there are two big papillary muscle. So there is mitral aortic discontinuity here, and then there is smooth wall ventricle, and it is in cross section, it is a circular one. And in cross section, right ventricle is a triangular one. And these are the two papillary muscles of the left ventricle, superior-posterior and inferior, and so inferior-anterior. And this is the fish mouth appearance. Exactly like a fish mouth, you have seen that the middle part is tightly packed and there are slits on each side. So how you will identify right ventricle and left ventricle? This is the summary. Right ventricle is coarse, that one is fine, and then all the things I have mentioned already. And now we have to come to other thing, what is common ventricle. If ventricular morphology cannot be determined with the character I have mentioned so far, then it is an indeterminate ventricle. Such chamber has either ambiguous morphological feature or has right and left ventricular free wall with an absent of the ventricular septum. So in free wall, you might get some of the character of the right and left, but the septum, as the septum is absent, you will not get the septal features. So sometimes the ventricle may be hypoplastic or may be underdeveloped, maybe a small one. So structurally, either they have only inlet part, or they have the trabecular part only, or the outlet part, or there may be absence of one component or two component or three component. So in tricuspid and mitral atresia, you will see inlet part is absent in right and left ventricle. In pulmonary and aortic, you will see outlet part is absent in right and left ventricle respectively. So if there is combined tricuspid atresia and pulmonary atresia, you will not see inlet and outlet part of the right ventricle, and only there will be the trabecular part. Now, after the ventricle, we'll come to the great arteries and aorta as it ascends. How you will identify the aorta? Because aorta is the one who give rise to three branches, three neck vessels. So in this way, you can identify. And then aortic sinuses are also identified by recognizing the origin of the coronary arteries. And the main pulmonary trunk, we can identify by seeing the bifurcation. So these points are very important for diagnosing transposition of great arteries. Sometimes the origin and first part of both the great vessel are almost similar. So many of our echocardiographers, they miss the transposition because they don't go distally. And by seeing only the proximal part, they diagnose. But at the end, we see that there is transposition of the great arteries. And then sometimes there is a common arterial trunk or a single arterial trunk. So common arterial trunk, which is seen in truncus arteriosus as a single trunk, we see in pulmonary atresia, or in the aortic atresia, there is only single trunk. So from this picture, you just now correlate with the theoretical part what I have mentioned. So in the aorta, you will see these three things, Otherwise, this is not an aorta. You will see the coronary orifice and also the sinuses. These round things are the sinuses. And then in the pulmonary, you will see these two bifurcation. After a while, you will see these two. So in the pulmonary atresia situation, you are not seeing another vessel here, but they are getting this right and left pulmonary artery, they are getting supply from the right and left ductal artery from the aorta. And then here you are seeing the truncus arteriosus. This is a common trunk. Both the vessels are coming at a time. So here again, you can see that how aorta appears, how pulmonary trunk looks like, and how common trunk looks like. So this is the common trunk. Pulmonary artery is coming out from the back of this common trunk, and then it is dividing into two branches. So there is a main pulmonary artery here. But sometimes there is no main pulmonary artery. There are only the two right and left pulmonary artery. They arise separately from the descending aorta. Sometimes they arise separately from this part also. So in individual disease, you will learn all those things. But today you will learn only the nomenclatures. And then what is conus? Conus is the outlet part. And it may be subpulmonary, with normally related great arteries, but sometime there is subaortic conus, sometime there is two conus. So every possibility is possible. Here is the pulmonary, below the subpulmonary, below the aorta, below both the great vessel, and there is nothing here. So any kind of combination is possible in the heart. Now, position of the cardiac segments. After knowing all the morphological situations, now we are coming to the topology part. We know the segment now where it is, whether the right atrium is in the right side or in the left side. So we will describe this in the form of some description. So first we'll know the first segment, atrial situs, then the ventricular situs and the great vessel situs. So we'll see one by one. The position of the morphological right atrium determines the cardiac situsness, as I have mentioned. So if right atrium is right-sided, it is a situs solitus. If it is left-sided, it is a situs inversus. If it is indeterminate, it is an ambiguous. So three kind of possibilities here for the atrium, the first segment of the heart, S, I, and A. So there are three possibilities for the first segment of the heart, where the identification structure is right atrium, which might be solitus, inversus, or ambiguous. Then the second one is the atrioventricular connection. This connection may be concordant. Everything is normal, right atrium, left ventricle, left atrium, left ventricle. Maybe discordant, right atrium, left ventricle, or left atrium, right ventricle. Again, it may be univentricular. Only one ventricle is in the below and both the atrium are communicating with it. So in univentricular type of atrioventricular communication, there are many possibilities. For example, it might be a double inlet. There are two separate inlet for the two atrium, only one inlet for the two atrium, and there is a common inlet. In this kind of single inlet, there may be mitral atresia or tricuspid atresia, but in common inlet, there is no atresia, but they share a common inlet for the both type, both side of the atrium. So we'll go to the figure to tell you these things. You are seeing that right atrium, right ventricle, left atrium, left ventricle, here AV bulb, AV bulb, these are concordant. So atrioventricular connection is concordant because this is tricuspid bulb below, mitral bulb above. So this is the mitral bulb for sure, and mitral bulb goes always with the left ventricle, tricuspid always goes with the right ventricle. So this is a concordant AV connection. Here, right ventricle with a valve which is at the higher level than that of this valve. So this is the mitral valve. And we know that if this is mitral valve, that this ventricle is left ventricle. For sure, there is no doubt about it. So there is discordant connection. Right atrium is connected with the left ventricle. Here you are seeing that this part, the septal part of the valve, septal leaflets, these are absent. And this is an ambiguous, both are right atrium. So this is an ambiguous communication of the atrium with the ventricle. So we have mentioned that if there is only univentricular atrioventricular connection, there are three possibilities. One is double inlet, one is single inlet, and one is common inlet. So let us go to the picture now. This is the univentricular connection. This is univentricular. Ventricle is single. What is it? There are two valves. So there is double inlet ventricle. Single inlet, but this one is atretic, tricuspid. This is a common inlet. Left atrium, right atrium, both are entering here through the same AV valve. So these are the description of the same thing again. An atrioventricular connection, if we come to the atrioventricular in D loop heart, right ventricle remain on the right side and of the left ventricle, and left ventricle remain on the left side of the right ventricle. So in D loop ventricle, right ventricle is in the right. In L loop ventricle, right ventricle is on the left. So the cardiac apex, as I have mentioned, I am not mentioning this again. And then you are seeing here that we always describe the position of the aorta in relation to our pulmonary artery. So pulmonary artery is the fix. And the transposition or the malposition of the aorta may be in any of the position below, all around the pulmonary artery. So aorta is moving around the pulmonary artery. So this is the right anterior. What are common? Common are right lateral. or dextral position, right anterior or D malpous deota or L anterior, this is the L malpous deota. So these three are very common, right lateral, right anterior and left anterior, which we have mentioned in this picture, dextral position of the aorta, which is in the right side, and right anterior aorta is commonly associated with the transposition of great arteries, and left anterior aorta is associated with the C transposition. This one is associated C transposition, this is D transposition. And dextroposed aorta, these are usually associated with the tetralogy of Fallot, like double outlet right ventricle, AV canal defect. These are the things where these are common. And now we are coming to the ventriculo-arterial connection. So each ventricle has its own artery, right ventricle has pulmonary and left ventricle has aorta, but this may not happen always. There is every chance of combination permutation in this case. So what are the possibilities? There might be like AV connection, it might be concordance, discordance, double, single, common, same like atrioventricular. So from the photograph, we can see that here you are seeing that this is a concordance and this is a discordance because aorta is coming out from the RV and pulmonary is coming out from the LV. Again, there may be double outlet. So RV has got double outlet. There may be single outlet. There is only an aorta and there is no pulmonary artery. And there may be a common outlet. There is a truncus with both pulmonary and aorta together. So these are the possibilities. Again, you have to know what is the overriding. Overriding may happen in case of the atrioventricular valve or in case of the semilunar valve. So in case of overriding of the atrioventricular valve, there is some malalignment between the atrial septum and the ventricular septum. And in case of overriding of the great vessel, there is some malalignment of the outlet part of the ventricular septum. And the rule is that if an atrium, which atrium you will consider to join to which ventricle is by the rule of 50%. An atrium is considered to join the ventricle into which more than 50% of that valve orifice emptied. So it is a 50% policy, not only for the atrioventricular valve, but also for the semilunar valve. And what is malalignment? Malalignment is the malalignment of the valves over any defect or over any VSD, which might be an atrioventricular valve or might be a semilunar valve. And 50% rule is applied also for the semilunar valve. So here you are seeing that the black one is atrial septum and white one is the ventricular septum. And you are seeing this is the lateral malalignment, like there are various kinds of malalignment. You don't need to know this. So then these are the other types of malalignment also. I will answer your question after my presentation because already we have too long time and prayer time is coming soon. I'm trying to finish it completely, but inshallah, I will answer your question later. And then now you are seeing here that what is this? This is one kind of just a minute. I think that you are seeing, but I am not seeing because something is coming in the top of my computer. So I wish that you are seeing here. I want to show you the overriding. So you are seeing here, this is a normal one. Concordant connection, there is a VSD here, but the connection is concordant. Now here you see that this valve, the septal part has started moving on this side. That means that the atrial septum, there is leftward shiftment, shifting of the atrial septum on the left side. So it is coming on the left side gradually. Here still there is concordance, but here you see there is overriding of this septum. And there is double inlet of the LV because right atrium is now opening into the LV. So there is double inlet as a result of this overriding of the tricuspid valve. And if it is more than 50% on this side, then RV will not get it. And this is the part of the LV. So this is a double inlet LV by definition. And here all is for LV. There is no doubt. So this is for sure a double inlet LV. And this is hypoplastic RV. If there is any outlet, so it is an outlet chamber only. Now is the 50% rule for the atrioventricular valve. You are seeing that this is the right ventricle and this is the right atrium. as more than, this is the whole 100%. This is the whole 100% of the atrioventricular valve, and this is more than 50% to the right ventricle and only this small percent for the left ventricle. So what is it? This is the concordant. RA is connected with the RB. And here you see RA is connected more than 50% with this part. So this is discordant. RA is connected with the LV. Here again, we can see in the vessel part, aorta part, this is the concordant connection, pulmonary artery from the RB and aorta from the LV, but here still, still it is from the concordance is maintained. But here what happened, there is rightward shifting of the outlet septum. So outlet septum is gradually moving right. And what has happened at the end? At the end, we have seen that there is a double outlet right ventricle. So this double outlet, before that it was like tetralogy of Fallot. And then more rightward shifting results in complete double outlet right ventricle. And now here, this is the aorta, whole aorta 100%. If it is more than 50% of the LV, it is the part of the LV then. So this is not a discordant. And here it is like discordant. So RB is getting the aorta more than that of the LV. So this is the principles of determining the connection. And then straddling, I think you know about the straddling. Straddling is true only for the atrioventricular valve. And straddling never ever happened in the seminal valve. And straddling is always associated with the ventricular septal defect. Otherwise, through which defect the valve will straddle. So straddling is always associated. This is also a formula, as like A plus B whole square. This is a formula. So what is it here is the tricuspid valve. This is the ventricular septum. And there is a VSD here. And now this valve has crossed this VSD coming into this side. This is the straddling. And this is the chorda tendini. This is also the chorda tendini of the septal leaflet coming here and connecting with the septum on the left side of the ventricle. And now here you are seeing the type of the straddling. This is the type A, only the top part of the septum, then in the middle part of the septum, and then in the free wall of the left ventricle. This is very dangerous type of one. You see that the cavity is divided into two parts because this valve has crossed the here into the free wall. So there are three types of straddling. So what is important? Straddling is associated always with the VSD. So overriding and straddling is very important. Now coming to the segmental possibilities at each level, I said in the atrial level, there are three kinds of possibilities, situs solitus, situs involutus, and situs ambiguus. In ventricle level, two things is possible only. Three things also possible. This is D and L, and another may be indeterminate. And then great arteries level, situs solitus, inversus, dextro position, and then levo position. So these four are true for the great arteries. Now this is the last slide of this one. Now, this is the mathematics. Now, we can do solve some example now. So what is it? RA, RB, LA, LB, RB, PA, LB, AO. So what is it? It is the most perfect one. It is SDS. And where it is, what is it? RB to AO, LB to PA. What is it? S, situs solitus in the atrium, RA and LA. D-loop ventricle in the ventricle. But here is the problem. What is it? There is dextro malposition because this is in the right side. So this is dextro. Dextro means right. So dextro malposition of the great arteries. So this is the SDD. And then here again, see RA here, LA here, but LV is here. So this is an L-loop ventricle, but this LV is giving rise to pulmonary artery, which is a discordance. So there is double discordance, RA and LV, LV and PA. So if there is double discordant connection, circulation is corrected. How circulation is corrected? Because this is the desaturated blood here. It is coming from the RA to the LV and then it is going to the lungs. So our aim is to send the desaturated blood to the lungs. Here we are sending, though there are two discordants, but ultimately the desaturated blood is going to the lungs. So our purpose is served. So here circulation is corrected, though there is two discordant connection. That's why its name is corrected transposition of the great arteries. Another name is levo transposition. And this one is here again, like if you can see, you will be able to understand that R and RB, L and LB. But here again, there is some kind of malposition. Aorta must be a posterior structure, but you are seeing here that aorta has come to the anterior and to connected to the RB. And also it is going in a wrong way. It is going towards the left side, not going towards the right side. So this is a Lebo transposition. So all kind of combination are here, but you can do some more exercise from here, LLB, RARB. Again, you are seeing that this is an inverse situation. All the left-sided structure are coming to the left, right side, and right-sided structure are coming to the left side. So this is normal, but inverse. This is a normal situation for the inverse condition. And again, here say RARB, LALB, but these two has changed. LALB, RARB, but these two has changed. RA and LB, here there is discordant connection, but here one thing is very interesting, that LB is giving right to aorta. So there is only one discordance. There, it is not like corrected transposition. There is discordance in this level only, but there is no discordance in this level. So this kind of patient will present with cyanosis, because desaturation blood, desaturated blood from right atrium will come to the left ventricle and directly will enter into the body through the aorta. So what will happen? Patient will be desaturated. And name of this situation is ventricular inversion. So this is all about actually the description part. And I think we have passed a long time. And I intended to show you some of the echocardiography, how to diagnose this. But today, I think it's a too long lecture. And thank you very much for attending this long lecture. And if you are benefited from this lecture, I will be very happy to know that from you. So, no.